I haven't talked about sugar, nor have I tasted any sugar, even fake sugar, for the last 16 days. Are the 12 people still with me? Francisco, you're still there?
Still hanging.
All right, we're still hanging in there. I know Ryan is. Ryan? Why are you all sad? That's what Eliza says. But I thought of to kind of give you an introduction to the message today. I'm going to talk about sugar. In fact, I'm going to show you a video about sugar. I'm so sorry. But many, many years ago, when this church was started as Philippine Christian Fellowship, we had a founder named Manong Fernandez. And some of you may not know her, many of you know her still. She long ago passed away, but I remember that she always brings dessert to church. And can somebody tell me her most famous or her most favorite dessert? You guys remember? Manang's favorite dessert that she makes. Nobody remembers? All right, it's carioca. You guys remember that? It's a chewy, it's chewy sweet rice balls. And what I'm going to do today is show you. I frequent this website on YouTube called Panlasang Pinoy. For those of you who don't know how to cook, which that means me, especially Filipino food. I know just some, but not all. But panlasangpinoy.com, I really like the way this guy, I forgot his name, Morano, that's his last name, cooks the food and shows it to you because it makes it so easy to remember and understand. And I'm sure, you know, those of you, our pastry chef is here, so I don't want to talk too much. But anyway, this is a great dessert, and I want to show you something, and just pay attention about that. All right, so we're not going to play the whole thing, but when he's starting to fry it, we'll stop. There you go. Thank you, Luz. Only Luz. Were you taking notes? She's taking notes. If let's say this is the first time that you've seen this, and I'm sure for those of you who cannot understand Tagalog, you're probably catching a few things, but you can see at least that how it's being done. Well, let's say, for example, that there's no way to repeat the video. There's no way to go back to YouTube and pay attention again. There's no way for you to jot down any notes. Assuming you haven't done carioca before, you haven't made that, are you going to be able to recreate that in your kitchen? And some of you who probably have a knack for cooking, who have very good memory, will probably get it right away and say, you know, I'll be able to do that. Some people here might say, well, I think it'll be better to do this instead of doing that. So they will just do their own thing. What am I trying to say here? The key is, will you be able to remember what you saw? Will you be able to remember what the steps are going to be? Will you, like, let's say for example, it's not carioca. Let's say for example, you're a witness to a crime. Will you be able to remember the crime scene? Will you be able to remember the person who passed by and you can report to the police? Yes, I did see a person pass by, and the police surely will always ask, how tall is the person? Can you describe the person? Will you be able to do that? It has something to do with our verse today. That's why I want you to go to James chapter 1. And some of you who were with me in our Bible study last Friday, you'll remember this. But James chapter 1, verse 19 is where I'm going to start. Sometimes it's hard to find James. It's towards the end of the New Testament. That's no problem. I'll wait for you. If you don't have your Bibles with you, you should bring it next time. If not, it's up here. And we can go ahead and read it. James chapter 1, and I'm going to start from verse 19. My dear brothers, take note of this. Everyone should be quick to listen, slow to speak, and slow to become angry. For man's anger does not bring about the righteous life that God desires. Therefore, get rid of all moral filth and the evil that is so prevalent, and humbly accept the word planted in you, which can save you. Do not merely listen to the word and so deceive yourselves. Do what it says. Anyone who listens to the word but does not do what it says is like a man who looks at his face in a mirror and after looking at himself goes away and immediately forgets what he looks like. Verse 25, and we're going to stop on verse 25. But the man who looks intently into the perfect law that gives freedom and continues to do this, not forgetting what he has heard, but doing it, he will be blessed in what he does. I still don't see carioca in that verse, Pastor Jay. First, this whole group of scripture from the book of James talks about the use of a mirror. And if you have a mirror with you, you can look at it. But usually, our women would have mirrors with them. Our guys, if you have a mirror with you, there's something wrong with you. But if you have a mirror, if you don't have a mirror, you usually go to the men's bathroom to kind of just see how you are. But if you look at verses 23, 25, it talks about this mirror image, and it's being used for examination. Going back to 23 to 25, let's put that up again. Anyone who listens to the word but does not do what it says is like a man who looks at his face in the mirror. So if you look at the mirror, James is using the mirror as what? An illustration for the word. Verse 24. And after looking at himself, goes away and immediately forgets what he looks like. Which we do all the time when we're looking at a mirror, isn't that true? We look at the mirror and we're going, okay, wait, did I remember? Especially us when we're getting older, we forget what we looked like 2 minutes ago. So we keep looking at the mirror. Those of you who walk by the mall, you know, all those you walk in a mall, through the stores, you're going to see mirrors upon mirrors and stuff. I'm very sure every time you pass by, you're not only looking at what's on the what is that called? You know, what's on display. But you're also looking to make sure that you look okay, that you don't have any rice stuck in your face or something like that. But when it talks about the mirror, it talks about the Word of God. And whenever we use the mirror or the Word of God, the main purpose of owning the mirror is to be able to see yourself, right? And that's exactly what James is talking about. As we look into the mirror of God's Word, we see ourselves for who we really are. We see ourselves for who we really are. James mentioned several mistakes people make as they look into God's mirror. Number one, they merely glance at themselves. See, when we look at a mirror, we don't just glance. But sometimes we do. We just kind of glance at ourselves and try to memorize that. Just like the little carioca recipe that I put up. You know, I don't know if you still remember, but you know, that was just a glance. You were not really able to see it. You were not able to take down notes. In fact, you're not able to go back to YouTube until later to figure it out. But what if I give you glutinous rice right now and brown sugar, and I want you to make one? It's going to be hard to do that because you merely glance at the video, and that's what James is talking about. When we look at the Word of God, these are the mistakes that we make. We merely glance at it. We don't really look into it. We don't do it every time. But YouTube, that guy has like 244,000 views. There's so many people have viewed that video. And not only that, they viewed it many times. And so they don't just glance at it. But that's what happens when we look at the Word of God. We make that mistake of merely glancing on it. Not only that. When we glance at it, we forget what we just saw. So I'm going to ask you again, do you guys remember the recipe? Do you guys remember the four ingredients that's in that recipe? Same thing when we look at the Word of God. We look at it, but we quickly forget what we see. And then finally, the third mistake that we make is that we fail to obey what the Word tells us to do. So, in case you're looking at a mirror and you're going to make that parallel, if you look at the mirror, you merely glance at it. That's what James said. You forget what you see. And the worst part is, you fail to do what you're supposed to do. If there's something wrong with your face, you need to fix it. Same thing with the Word of God. If we are to use God's mirror profitably, we need to make sure that we gaze into it carefully and with serious intent. I did not tell you ahead of time that I'm going to show you a video of a recipe, because I didn't want you to gaze at it intently. I want you to look at it, because it's not just something that a passenger just throws at you beginning of the sermon. But if we are to use God's mirror or God's word as a mirror profitably, we need to make sure that we gaze into it carefully, not only carefully, but with serious intent. Oh, serious intent. You know, I always remember, parents. Parents, especially my older sister, not me, but my oldest sister, I'm not going to tell her your name. But anyway, you know, when guys would come, when she was young and teenager, when guys would come to the house, that's how they used to court people, you know. Nowadays, you guys don't go to the houses anymore. But, you know, they would used to come to our house, and my father would always say, you know, does that guy have a serious intent? Or he's just here to kind of just hang out? What kind of guy is that? Or do you have serious intent? And that's what we are supposed to do when we are to use God's mirror profitably. No quick glances would do. We need to examine our own hearts and live in the light of God's word. And this requires what? It requires time. It requires attention. It requires sincere devotion. If you really want to know how to make carioca, that is not the only time you're going to see it. You got to see it over and over again. You got to join 244,000 people or times that it's being viewed. You're also going to take a piece of paper like Luz was doing, and you're going to start writing. Oh, wow, that's new. I don't put that. But they do. Oh, maybe I'll try that. Oh, here's the way that he was shaping those things into a ball. And, you know, they put it into a skewer. And so, you know, that's maybe something that I can do. It requires time, it requires attention, it requires sincere devotion. It cannot be 5 minutes. I'm not talking about karaoke anymore. I'm talking about the Word of God. It requires 5 minutes, more than 5 minutes. 5 minutes with a day with God will never accomplish a deep spiritual examination the way James wants us to do it. You know, let me tell you something that has been happening to me this week, and I would hear or listen to a person say something, and I would start have feelings of self-pity. I would start have feelings of discouragement, I'm sorry. And I would think that person has too much pride, and I'm the humble one. And I'm always saying, gee, yeah, I'm the humble one. You're the one who's saying that. Then I'd go to the Word of God. And for some reason this week, I've been reading James and Acts also. In James, because James is in Acts, and I was trying to see, you know, how he came in there. But looking at the book of James, you know, I read one verse, that one, and voila, the Word of God rescues me from my feelings. Even a short verse would make me re-examine myself. A short verse can rescue us from ourselves. A short verse can tell us, you're not the humble one. Think again. You're not the one. That person is not the one with the pride. Think again. Maybe it's you. Maybe it's you that needs to come down from where you're at. Examination is only the first purpose of the mirror of the Word of the Word of God. The second purpose, according to James and what we read, is restoration. The mirror of God not only examines us, it also and it reveals our sins. Okay, right? It examines us. It reveals our sins. It also helps us to cleanse our sins. Helps us to cleanse our sins. So I'm going to back up a little bit and go back to verse 21. So I'm going to ask Hannah to put that up again. Therefore, verse 21 says, get rid of all moral filth and evil that is so prevalent, and humbly accept the word planted in you, which can what? Save you. The next verse says, do what it says, basically. It gives us the promise of cleansing as we look at the Word of God. So James is promising, when we look at the Word of God intently, with serious intent, not just a normal gaze, but with serious intent, and over again, if it has to be, just like watching YouTube, over and over if it has to be, not only will it tell us what we are and what we look like, it also gives us the ability not for us to cleanse our sins, but to see our sins and to give that to the Lord and maybe not do it again. Nobody says that, but I'm going to say that again. And maybe not do it again. A lot of times you go, oh, we sin because, you know, ako ay tao lamang. I sin because that is human nature. I sin because it's of the flesh. Well, you know, there's a way not to do it again. Believe it or not. Maybe many, many pastors, many, many churches don't want to say that because we want to stay with that, well, you know, we sin. And so we ask for forgiveness. What is James telling us in this? By humbly accepting the word planted in us, it will what? Just make us feel good? Just make us wise? No, it saves us. It says there, it saves us. And finally, after the Lord restores us, after the Lord shows us in His word what we look like, after the Lord restores us, it will change us so that we will grow in grace and not commit that sin again. Too many believers confess their sins and claim forgiveness, but never grow spiritually to conquer self and sin. This is what I'm talking about a while ago. In our lives, after examination, after restoration, there must be, it's the T word, transformation. After the examination and after the restoration, there needs to be transformation. There must be, another word for transformation is what? Starts with a C.
Change.
There must be change. Look at verse 25. But the man who looks intently into the perfect law that gives freedom and continues to do this, not forgetting what he has heard, but what? Doing it, he will be blessed in what he does. And sometimes the word blessed is not enough. Because sometimes we look at the word blessed like, I'm blessed. Everyone is blessed. You ask everyone who goes around, walks around, and calls themselves a Christian, how are you today, my brother? I'm blessed. As if it's just this thing. But I think the word blessed here means so much more. When a child of God looks into the Word of God, he sees the Son of God. And he is transformed by the Spirit of God. When we look into the Word of God and we see Jesus in there, we get transformed by His Spirit. The word change, because that's what it says here. You will be changed. The word change in the Greek gives us our English word metamorphosis, which means a change on the outside that comes from the inside. And so every time I ask, you know, school kids, you know, when you think about metamorphosis, what's the first thing that comes to your mind? You're talking about a worm that becomes a butterfly, right? That's the most familiar metamorphosis to us. When a believer spends time looking into the Word and seeing Christ, he is transformed. You are transformed. And the glory of Christ on the inside transforms the outside. I was telling you a while ago that we talked about this in Bible study last Friday. And this book of James is very practical. We kind of decided that. And we started, and that's why when we started reading the Word, we started talking about work. We started talking about church. We started talking about people that we meet every day, people around us, and how we react to what they say. Now, what kind of behavior we have, what kind of character we have at work, and what kind of behavior we have, and how do we react when something is said to us. And here's the thing. We can know all the terms about the Word of God. We can know all that it is to learn about Christianity. But if there's no application, the Bible says it's not effective. It's not effective. You know, one thing we agreed on last Friday is how many times have we read? How many times have we studied? How many times have we talked about the first chapter of James? How many times? Maybe not from this church. Maybe you've read it somewhere else. Maybe you've heard a pastor say that. Maybe you've read it in a book. But how many times have you read? How many times have you studied? How many times have you talked about the first chapter of James? And yet we forget what it says. And yet we forget what it says. Take a look at verse 26 with fresh eyes and fresh ears right now. Because I know you've read this many times. But I want you to look at verse 26 with fresh eyes and ears. Those who consider themselves religious and yet do not keep a tight rein on their tongues deceive themselves, and their religion is, oh, it hurts. What is it? Worthless. Worthless. Read that again. Those who consider themselves religious and yet do not keep a tight rein on their tongues deceive themselves, and their religion is worthless. I consider myself a Christian. I talk like a Christian. I say many things that are Christian. My life revolves around Christianity. But if I cannot keep my mouth shut, and if I do not go back to verse 19 of this chapter that says everyone should be quick to listen, slow to speak, and slow to become angry. Many of us have mistaken the idea that hearing a good sermon is what makes them grow and get God's blessing. Many of us have mistaken the idea that hearing a good sermon, in fact, you know, I've read many, many stories about churches where they're never there during praise and worship, but everyone else comes right before the sermon, because to them, the most important part is the sermon. Many of us have mistaken the idea that hearing a good sermon, hopefully it's a good sermon, is what makes them grow and grow and get God's blessing. I said a while ago, I say many things that are Christian. I consider myself a Christian. But if I cannot keep my mouth shut, and I cannot be quick to listen, slow to speak, and slow to become angry, then it's worthless, James said in the Word. It's too easy to look into God's Word and instantly forget it and set it aside. This results in people who are, and this is, I love this, I read this somewhere, this last few words. This results in people who are informed but not transformed. Think about those words. This results in people who are informed. Oh my, we are so informed. You Google everything. You see everything and you know, you go, I know all this, Pastor James. I've been born and raised in the church. I know all these terms. I speak Christian. These results in people who are so informed but never transformed. You can look at what you're learning in seeking Allah, finding Jesus, and you've got the real story down. You've got the real story down. You get what you're learning, the lessons that you have. You're reading Dr. Lawrence's book and you're going, yeah, that's wonderful. I got it down. And whatever you're learning in Bible study, or maybe in your own studies, maybe in school, maybe in class, maybe in your personal devotion, maybe in your daily devotion, but if we forget and set aside God's Word, we are a bunch of informed people and never transformed. So what can we do while reading the Word to ensure that we won't quickly forget what it says? Maybe we need to take a regular inventory of our spiritual lives to help us see if we're being transformed. Maybe you can, and when we were doing this last Friday, we were saying, do we believe we're more or less judgmental than a year ago? Think about that. Are we more judgmental now, or were we more judgmental a year ago? Are you now more approachable? Are you less approachable? Are you more energized in your spiritual walk? Are you more energized to read the Word of God? I love that mirrors make me look thin. Or some of the mirrors maybe make you look tall. I like that, thin and tall. But have you ever let your image be warped into thinking that you're better than someone else? I have let myself become much taller in my own eyes than I really am, much thinner in my own eyes than I really am, much better in my own eyes than I really am. And we become, and I become like the priest and the Levite in the story of the Good Samaritan. I'm too good to do this. We got the title, born again Christians. We've got the experience. Like, you know, American Express, member since 1990. Christian since this time. Church-going member since 1990. We read the Bible many times over, know the theology, know the law of salvation. We know many things. We got the speech down. We speak it every day. In fact, we even tell others what to believe, how to believe, when to believe, why to believe. Yet the Word cautions us when it says, those who consider themselves religious and yet do not keep a tight rein on their tongues deceive themselves, and their religion is worthless. Be transformed, church, by the renewing of your minds. Amen? Amen. Please stand and we're going to pray.